Welcome to Everything Life and Real Estate. Let's get started with our hosts, Linda McKissack and Dana Gentry.
Hi, everyone. Welcome to Everything Life and Real Estate. I'm Linda McKissack.
And I'm Dana Gentry.
Hey, Dana. So you got back from the beach and I left the beach. We're both very sad. The beach, right?
Yes.
What's been going on with you since you've been back from the beach? You went to Austin. Where else did you go?
Yes, I went straight from San Diego to Austin, and I got to spend a day and a half with Gary Keller, which was incredible. I took, as normal, about a bajillion pages of notes, so that was awesome. And then from there, I went back home to Lexington, literally for one day, and then I drove through the night to come to Charleston so I can work here for a couple of days and get ready for Christmas. So I'm going to spend Christmas here. What about you?
Love it. Well, same thing. I did stay a few extra days. I was kind of lonely once y'all left, though. I was kind of sad, but I adjusted quickly. And then we came home. Let's see. It's such a blur. I came home and immediately got off the plane and had our McKissack Business Systems Christmas party. So that was fun. Yeah. I made them do the cakewalk that you wouldn't do at the regional Christmas party. And everybody had fun. They liked
it. So what exactly was it? Everyone brought a cake and everyone left with a cake, or no?
No, I just brought all the cakes because I didn't know all the rules. And you know, I'm never going to do anything that far in advance. So I had to Google on the plane, how do you do a cakewalk? Because I couldn't remember. So, but the good news is my staff already had it all figured out and I didn't have to do anything but try to play the music. However, I did learn from doing that exercise that I've got to get some more technology-minded people on my team because no one knew how to make the music go over our fancy speaker system we have. So note to self, add someone to the team next year that is a little more technologist than the ones we have. I have great people and they're all loyal and been with me a long time, but they are a little bit... in the era that I come from, where that's not our first thought, it's our last thought. So
yeah, no, that makes sense. Well, today I'm actually excited because this is our 52nd episode. So 1 year.
Really? I just did not think it was that long. It goes by so fast. When you just get to do the thing you love, which is talk and talk to each other, it just goes fast. I love it.
I know. I couldn't believe it.
I did want to clarify because I felt like last podcast, Dana, you and I kind of rushed through, and I wanted to explain to everybody listening that listened to the number 51 episode. The reason we kind of rushed at the end is we were actually going through our intentions for that must happen by the end of December 31st, 2020. And David Osborne, who has been our business partner for many years, he's also the author of Wealth Can't Wait, and he'll be on our podcast later this year. Him and his family were actually coming over to the beach house to see it. And so we knew it was going to be loud and we were just trying to hurry. So just for anybody who's thinking, what in the world? I felt like they were just rushing it there at the end. So I think we're going to go back and hit a couple of more of our goals that we didn't have. And then we're going to talk a little bit about what you and I are discovering, starting off with our one thing planner for 2020. So I can't remember which one I stopped with, but for me, I think one of them I didn't say was, I just have loved having a system around anything that's important to me, but I'm procrastinating on. So if I begin to procrastinate, I know I need a who and I need a system around it. So I think a big thing for me for 2019 was just to recognize that anytime I procrastinate around anything, it's because I'm trying to do the how. And yeah. And you and I love to come up with ideas and we'd love to have other people around us that love the how part of it. And so that one was a big lesson, and I want to carry that into 2020. And, you know, I think I did say my lunch and learn either on Zoom or in person. Mm-hmm. I did say that one. But I also want to meet top people who are already in our company that I may not know as well. I may have met them vaguely, but to get to know them better. If they're in our top 100 in the region and I don't know a little bit about them that I could explain to you, then they're on my list to get to know better in 2020. I did end with Dan Sullivan will be on our podcast. So I got to already check something off for 2020, which is kind of fun. I put on there to do another book. I want to do a small book this time and I want to get that done in 2020.
Yep.
And do a giving experience with my grandchildren to teach them how to give to people who are less fortunate.
Oh, that's a good one. I love that one.
Yeah. I find that we think about it and we do it ourselves, but do we include other people that it might be a great lesson? Because I think we're all put on this earth to learn from each other. And yeah. I think anytime you can share any experiences you have with other people, you give someone else a chance to learn something. And the other thing I put on here is to find a writer on staff for my team. I have so many ideas and I can't write. I'm a talker. I was telling Tyler before we jumped on this podcast that I have totally figured out that I need people around me that construct and put together everything. So all I'm doing is talking to people. I'm talking to people inside our company. I'm talking to agents outside of our company. I'm talking to you. I'm talking to people who are interesting to me that I can learn from. And so for 2020, a gap we're going to have in our system is someone who can take all the information and do some writing with it, because writing's not my strong suit. And then the last one I'll say is to, you know, have more of a process that I do for every project I think of. I've shared the impact filter that I learned from Dan Sullivan with you, but I've learned that if I can just take that little bit of time and I can fill out that impact filter to figure out why a project would be important to me, that I can either disregard the project or I can move it higher up on my priority list, or I can at least give clarity to the people who are going to actually pull that project off.
I love that. Yep, that's a good one. Yeah, I was trying to think back to the ones that I shared from my list and the ones that I didn't share. And actually, first, I want to say thanks to everybody who listened and reached out to me about finding something that I love for working out. I had several people message me on Instagram and say, for sure, try Orange Theory. And then I had probably 15 people say, get a Peloton.
And you know, you can come use my new one over at Anna and Chris's house.
That's what I say. I think the treadmill would be better for me. So Chris and Caitlin got their bike yesterday. And so I saw it at their house yesterday. And I had no clue you could get on and do all that stuff on the floor, like off of the bike. There was like the yoga and all that stuff.
Yes. I think eventually they'll own the space for virtual workout. I haven't done the weights yet because it's still not enough accountability to make me to pick up a weight. So I still have my trainer come, but my goal is to someday maybe do yoga with my Peloton and weights and everything else. So
yeah, I thought that was super cool. So now I'm kind of on the hook of maybe I need a Peloton treadmill. So anyway, that was cool for that people were reaching out, and I still am going to try Orange Theory. The only couple things I had on my list that I didn't get to share were to be, and you know, going with our theme, intentional, that we both picked our word of the year for. Oh, which by the way, I'll go ahead and tell you, I'm sending you this in the mail. I don't know that you'll be able to see this, but I found these super cool beaded bracelets. They're really teeny tiny, and they're just like made out of rope, but they are called intentional bracelets. And the purpose is you wear it every day next to your watch. And so when you look at it, you remember that you're supposed to be being intentional with everything that you're doing. So I got one for me. I got one for you. I got to stick it in the mail to you. So continuing with the intentional theme for next year, a big thing that I had was to do more videos and vlogs, which is something, you know, we've been obviously talking to Tyler and Kate a lot about. And I just want to be really intentional and purposeful with video content in 2020, because I've been hearing and reading all these statistics and doing all this research around a lot of people, which is awesome and why they listen to podcasts, I'm sure, but they don't even want to read anymore. Like if you're not having some sort of a video or a vlog, then I feel like we're behind. So that was one thing I'm going to be very intentional about in 2020. The other thing you kind of hit on, but I wrote down, was to bring experiences that I get to experience to those around me that didn't get to experience those things. So being really intentional with that. And even I thought about tying two of those in together. And you know how John Maxwell challenged us to go back through all of our pictures this year and pick the ones that, you know, we told a story or that we had a lesson that we learned from. So I did that exercise, and I've shared it in a couple of my offices, just a couple of pictures in office meetings over the last month. But I think I'm going to do a video and through Loom or whatever, where I can share my screen and kind of show some of those and be able to share that different experiences that I did over the year and what the lessons were for those to be able to share with kind of people in my world. I thought that might be kind of fun and cool. So those were really my two big ones that I didn't share. I'm trying to read through my list. I think I pretty much did the rest of them. So yeah, that was that. Those were those two.
Awesome. Love it. I love every bit of that. See, you always inspire me to add things to my list also. So I love that. So let's switch gears and talk about our reflect and plan section of our one thing planner that you and I both love and dive into. And so the first question says, what were your biggest wins this past year? So if you were reflecting, and you know, I don't think we spend enough time reflecting. I know I'm one of those people that, oh, that was so last week or last year, or and I'm just moving on to the next thing. And I've just really learned that spending a little bit of time of reflecting can actually help you be better prepared for the next year. And so sometimes I'll just take my 30-day-to-glance calendar and I'll just kind of look back through there. My pictures also, like you mentioned, are a great way to realize how much you've actually accomplished. I'm pretty proud when I go back and look through my picture, especially with family. I feel like we've done such a great job of really spending time and having fun. And those, I wouldn't remember that without looking back at the pictures. So I love this reflect and plan off of 2019 to start your 2020 one thing planner.
And for the listeners that don't have this planner, we're going to give their 6 questions in the back. And so we'll just run through each of these 6 if, for those of you that may be writing them down if you don't have the planner. So, number 1 was, what were your biggest wins this year? So I had just a couple. So first, my Keller Williams office in Richmond, Kentucky, we like blew past our goals more than what we ever, ever, ever thought that we would do there. So that was a huge win. And then I felt like with the Columbus office, it's moving in the right direction. We've made a lot of great hires, a lot of great change. That was a big win. In the region, I felt like we had a huge win with our training and our culture this year. I felt like our training was just, we've gotten so many great comments and feedbacks about the training that we brought to our agents. So that was really good. I put the podcast success, I think, for our first year to have 60,000 or however many downloads. I feel like that was a big win for us. I know you and I just always say we don't even know if people are listening. We just enjoy doing it. And so that was a good win. And then I put in here launching the Airbnb in Lexington, and we just went live last week. And it's already booked for 3 weeks. So a lady staying there right now for 3 weeks in a row. We have bookings all the way up through April, and we haven't even been live for a week yet. I couldn't even believe it.
Oh my gosh, love it.
Yeah. So anyway, next time you and Jimmy come to Lexington, I gotta have you guys stay there. But that was like a big win. I love that. I also wrote down partnering with my friend Josh, who you know, to take over my real estate team and help me run that. That was a big, big win for me. And then in general, I just feel like this year I grew so much in my leadership capabilities. I just feel like I've learned so much in 2019 that I can't even, it's like crazy to think back over everything I've learned this year. And so to me, that's always a win because I just love to learn. So those were kind of my big ones. What about you?
Yeah, I think we could probably talk just on this one thing for a whole thing, because there's so many as you're speaking, I'm thinking, oh yes. And that for me also.
Yeah.
But I always think clarity is power. And anytime I can get clarity around something, it's super cool to me. And so getting clarity around who I want to be a hero to and not trying to be a hero to everybody. In 2019, especially, I realized that I love the real estate agent entrepreneur. I do. I have a heart for them. I am one. I think like one. I always put that hat on first, no matter how many other hats I put on. Yeah. And so getting clarity that's what gives me joy in what I want to do was super powerful for me, because now every decision I make, I just run it through that funnel. And if it's going to take me away from that, the answer is no. And if it's going to move me closer to that, then the answer is yes. Yes. So I love any time I can get clarity. So that was a big win for me. I also got really conscious about stopping doing the things that don't give me joy, that are kind of, even if they're just, I'm pretty good at them, but they kind of just agitate me a little. I'm going for the things that give me joy. And for me, talking to a realtor, helping a realtor, coaching a realtor, teaching a realtor, those things give me joy. And so just getting real clear about, you know, what gives me joy, because I think you're like this too, Dana. I'll just say yes and go get something done because I said yes to it, not without thinking, how much joy will I actually get out of doing that? And so we'll just plow through it. And so I'm going to be a little more conscious in 2020. And I did pretty good this year at getting clear about what things do give me joy. And then also just, you know, looking at my return on time. We're always good about measuring our return on money, but I think our time is our greatest asset. And so what is the return on time that a decision is going to give me? And, you know, will it give me energy or is it going to take my energy away? One of the things I feel like I really accomplished well in 2019 is having a team, the regional team around me that actually gives me energy. And that energy inspires me to be creative and come up with ideas and create visions. And so I love that. When you can kind of put that kind of team around you, it's priceless. And so for me in 2019, I feel like we're on great target for the regional team and doing that. And it's a lot of fun and it gives me energy. And so I'm for things that are going to give me energy moving into 2020.
Yep. Love that. One of the bad habits that I'm going to say that I showed goes in line with 1 year. So yeah, I think that's awesome. So the second question was, what did you accomplish that you're most proud of this year? And I had a couple things I wrote down on that. If I had to pick like the top three or four. Well, I'll start with the first one that is easy, that will seem silly to so many people, but for me was huge. The fact that I accomplished flying to London was a huge accomplishment for me because, you know, I kind of have a phobia of the flying across the water thing. So now I feel like I can go anywhere. So I feel great about that. I would say the second thing this year that I accomplished that I was really proud of was I've had more difficult and hard conversations this year than I probably total have had in my whole entire life. Yet I'm seeing so many positive outcomes from those hard and difficult conversations. So I'm proud that I accomplished those and that I finally feel like even though they're not easy and honestly they suck so bad and I don't sleep and I dread them, I'm proud that I've accomplished feeling good about having them. And I think it's just because now I care so much that it's easier to have the hard conversations. And then I've been able to see the positive results. And not every single one of them has, you know, ended like with sunshine and rainbows. Yet majority of them have. And it's been a good thing. And so I'm proud that I've been able to accomplish getting better at having those, I guess would be the best way to say it.
Well, it's a great thing when you can have a hard conversation and it actually enriches the relationship. And, you know, I always think about the principles of fierce. One of the reasons I teach it every year is because I don't think the hard conversations ever get a lot easier. In other words, the, you know, anticipation around them, the angst around them, that kind of stuff, because there's always that unknown that you don't know how the other person's going to respond. I mean, you've got the three ways most people do it, defend, deflect, or deny. And mm-hmm. you can kind of be ready, but you just don't really know. And so I think it's that uncertainty that makes the angst be around the fierce conversation, the hard conversations. However, there's such a value and a nugget when you can actually enrich a relationship and you can sense and feel that you've enriched that relationship from that conversation. It just takes such courage to do it. I love it. That's a great accomplishment.
I was trying to think back. I'm like, it sounds kind of silly to say that, but honestly, I'm really proud of that.
Yeah. And especially, you know, for people who just want everybody to love them and your whole brain of thought is if I say something hard, someone's not going to love me. You got to kind of change that whole thinking around that because the truth is people, if they're ready to get the message, usually appreciate the fact that you were willing to have the hard conversation with them. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I've gotten thank yous afterwards. I mean, like ones I've literally wanted to vomit before I've had afterwards have ended with thank you. So it's just, I think it's an accomplishment for me for sure. And then actually the last one I wrote down this year that I'm really kind of proud of is I actually stuck to my planner this year. And that's, I feel like I'm getting better at, I'm planning my day or I'm running my day instead of my day running me, which is pretty much how I've lived the last 15 years of my real estate life. And a lot of that, I definitely give praise to the One Thing Planner for. I'm just so obsessed with this planner. I've stuck to my planner much better in 2019. And so that was a big accomplishment for me too.
I love it. So yeah, I put under where you put it under the first one, I put the podcast under the second one, and I'm proud of it, most proud of it, because of what it meant I had to do. I stopped trying to figure out the how and just gave it to a who. And yeah. So the reason I love doing it, and I love that we do it, and I'm proud that what it took to do it was meant I had to let go of the how to do it, and I didn't have to have 100% figured out. And it wasn't perfect, and it's still not perfect, but man, are we about to come out of the shoot with a great podcast, great sounding, yes. Great, all the things that are so much better. But if you and I had waited till they were at that spot, you and I would have never gone. So yeah. You go at 80% and then you move it to 100%. So I'm really proud of that, because I know the inner workings of what it took for you and I to be willing to do that was yeah. To let go of that it wasn't going to be perfect, and the how, we don't know how, we still don't hardly know how to turn these microphones on, but we didn't need to know all that, right? We just needed to find the right who, and the rest would kind of work itself out. So I'm real proud of that too.
Yeah, for sure.
And then I got a lot of clarity around what other who's I need in 2020. And I've kind of avoided that in the past. I know I've needed more who's, but I've kind of avoided it because I almost didn't want to have, I know this sounds crazy, but I didn't want to have the obligation of what it means when you invite somebody into your life to be a part of your team or part of your vision. Mm-hmm. It's almost like I do love to talk, but I don't like to talk about what Dan Sullen would call backstage stuff and what I would call behind the curtain stuff. I only like to talk about the ideas and the things that are going to be on the front stage. And so there was a little bit of a hesitance to me to bring more people in my life that I would feel bad about not doing those things with. So I got real clarity around who they are, and I'm going to make the system work for me. In other words, if it means I have to do a Zoom call with people instead of face to face, I'm just going to accept that and do it. And I'm going to make the communication be on the terms that I enjoy doing it. In other words, you know, they have to do an impact filter before they come to me with something. If I'm going to ask them to do a project, I have to do an impact filter for them. So I'm putting more standards around it, and it's making me release the fact that I think I was hesitating on putting the people in my life that I needed because of what responsibility it meant for me. Does that make sense?
Yeah, big time sense. Yes. I'm sure there's a lot of people that can relate to that. Honestly, I know I can for sure.
And then the last thing I would say on this one is I put a system in place to say no to all the training events that I get. I've picked two or three things that I will say yes to out of town. And other than that, all of my training will be in the region. Except for the only out-of-town training I'll do is career visioning, which is learning better how to put the talented people in your life, the process to do that. Because I think, number one, the better I get at that, the better I can teach other people to do it. And teaching it makes me better. And then the second one is fierce conversations, because if you're going to succeed with and through people, you're never going to stop needing to have those. And the better I get at having those, the more enriched relationships I'll have.
Yeah, and that just made me think, I don't know that we have that on the schedule, so we've got to get that for 2020, because it's just the best class, honestly. I always say, I wish everybody that I know could come to Fierce Conversations.
Even you know what, Dana, because I'm always thinking about productivity, and one of the things I just woke up in the middle of the year and said, why am I not telling everybody to do this? Everybody out there that's a realtor should bring their very best clients and pay for their ticket for Fierce Conversations. If you have a client that is a business person, career visioning or fierce conversations would be the most amazing gift you could give to those special clients who refer you business and have to deal with people. And I promise you, you will get transactions from that. There's no way you will not do that. And so I wouldn't think that, you know, I always say to everybody, I bring someone I love and care about, because I usually bring a family member. Mm-hmm. However, everybody should be bringing their best client.
Yeah, I totally agree with that, for sure. Yes, love it. Okay, so we're ready for number three?
Sure.
Okay, so number three was, what changes did you make in how you invest your time? And actually, you just kind of said one of the things that I wrote down, which was I said no to more things that don't move me forward. and honestly, that don't move me forward to my 5-year goals. And actually, I love you challenged me in San Diego of what Dan Sullivan said to you about the 25-year thing. So now I'm like really thinking, man, if it's not moving me forward to where I want to be in 25 years, should I be saying yes to that? So that was really good. One change that I also made this year in how I invested my time, actually time blocked for more family friend time this year. In the past that has been hard for me, and I definitely have not spent as much time with my friends or my family as much as I wish that I would have. And so I feel like in 2019, I was able to do that a little bit more. And all it meant was just me, rearranging some things or being more purposeful with my time, and being able to do that. And I've seen my two best friends, Chrissy and Kim, in 2019, probably more than I did like in the last 3 years combined, just because, we lost a friend. And it's just stuff like that really makes you think. And it's crazy I can overwork way, way, way too much. And so I've needed to prioritize that a little bit better. So that was a big change I made this year. And then the last thing I wrote down, which you and I definitely have even done together, but I have utilized Zoom so much. And that has been a game changer for me in how I invest my time. I mean, from appointments to even us doing our podcast to talking with recruits, to talking with coaching some of my top agents in the offices. I mean, how we communicate in the region, everything. Like, Zoom has completely transformed my life. And it's awesome because it's really helped me just make different decisions with my time. And it's such a time saver. Excuse me. So that was a big one for me, but those were the three that I had.
I love it. Yeah. Mine are along the same lines. I plan more in advance for important stuff. I'm a real quick start. I get an idea and I go without doing any planning. And so if it's an important project and I think I will decide that it's important by the impact filter, then I need to put a little more time, even if it's 20 or 30 minutes on my part to give clarity to the people who are going to pull it off. But just planning that a little bit more, I think is going to get me much better results. Because I always say, as a driver, you're always mad, not sure why you're mad. You're just plumb darn mad. Nobody ever does good enough or fast enough or any of those things. And 99% of the time, it's my problem. It's because I didn't give clarity around it. And so I'm disappointed with the results when really it should have started with my clarity around it in the instructions in the first place. So really getting investing time in some planning, which is not easy for me. So I'm probably going to need to make sure I always keep a system around it. And then also, the important things like relationships, I always think of people like when you and Adam came to the beach house last week. I love doing that. And I'm thinking, why am I not doing that in advance? Because if I go ahead and put it out there or put the invitation out there, like you and I put that on the calendar, I mean, months before.
Yeah.
And so my intentional with my time is to do more of that, because we love sharing our blessings with other people, our home and our beach house. And so just doing that stuff in advance, even to the point where you send the invitation out in advance, you pay for it in advance, you say it out loud to other people. Those kind of the things have helped me keep the intention around where and how I want to spend my time.
Yeah, I love that. I think that's such a good one. That was awesome. So number 4 was, what were your biggest regrets? What didn't you do that you wished that you had? And I just had like 3 quick ones. I'm sure there's a ton I could have thought of. I just had 3 quick ones on these. Number 1 was I should have hired. My biggest regret was not hiring an operations manager sooner. I'm so glad that hopefully I have one starting at the beginning of the year. However, it should have been probably 8 months ago. So that was one I think could have made a difference in my year this year if I would have done that sooner. The second one was, I really wish, and I'm going to do this in 2020, but I wish I would have done a mid-year retreat in the middle of the year for like 1 to 2 days, just to plan, reflect in all areas of my business. It even tells you exactly how to do it in the One Thing Planner after the month of June. And it's like, I had it starred and circled. And they call it the Reset Retreat. And it even gives you the questions and everything in here. And it's like the only part of my planner that's blank. So I wish I would have done that this year, because I just think it's good. You know, it goes so fast. Like, we blink and it's June every single time when the year starts. So I wish I would have done that. And that's definitely something I want to do in 2020 with the region, with my offices, with my team, with everything. Because I just think it's so good to say, okay, let's just not get till December. We're in June. So where are we at? Are we close to our goals? What do we have left that we want to do for the rest of the year? I was trying to find these questions. Yeah, where do you currently stand in relation to your goals? What's the gap between where you are and where you want to be? If you're behind, what's one thing you can do to close the gap? If you're ahead, do we need to raise our goals? And then what do we need to say no to in order to ensure our success? And really putting like a retreat together around that for a day. So I definitely want to do that. I regret not doing that this year.
Maybe we'll do that and give the results on our podcast. That'll hold you accountable. So mid-June, Dana will for sure have that done. So will Linda, and that'll be one of our podcasts.
Love it. Yes, that's awesome, because I just think it's such a good thing. And if it's good enough for Jay and Gary and Jeff, then it should be good enough for us.
Well, I love this. I love this biggest regrets, because I decided several years ago, after I watched my mother pass away with a lot of regrets. And I went to Gary's Quantum Leap, and I heard jump out at me, you know, you don't want to leave here with regrets. So regrets have been one of those things that I constantly ask myself, what would I regret if my life ended this year or this day or whatever? What are the things I would regret? And I'm just very clear about those things. So this one, I love that we put it in the form of, what are your biggest regrets from last year that you wished you had done? And again, I always add a lot of the same things, but for me, doing more of the career visioning process on people, because the process is such a value that you give someone when you put them through it. And I should be more committed to having more of those on my calendar, because it's such a gift to other people. And lives get changed. I know my life was changed when I got put through it. And so I think it's just such a gift to give people. And so I wish I'd had more people on my schedule to take them through the career visioning process. The other thing I put on here is I wished I had looked for more who's to do my hows. I hate hows, and I don't want to do any hows. I hate them. They bog me down. I'm terrible at them, and they make my life with low energy. So I need more who's that love to do the hows. And then the last one I put is, grow the region more, because I've seen more lives changed since I've been going to Ohio, Indiana, and Kentucky since 2000. And when someone sends me a note or a text, or they meet me and they say, you know, thank you so much, you changed our life, it really makes me realize I need to quit thinking about hitting the goals of growing the region, and I need to change it to change more lives by growing the region. I know for a fact that I've changed people's lives having gone up there since 2000. And so why I don't look at it through that lens and realize that the only thing standing between me doing it back then and me doing it now is the commitment level that I have to it. I had a stronger commitment level to do it back then. And so all I got to do is change the way I look at our regional goals. Our regional goals really isn't about, you know, just the numbers. It's about the lives that we're actually going to be able to change. And without a doubt, I know we do change those lives when we grow the region. And so changing that to where I'm spending more time asking myself, how many lives am I changing right now? What am I doing to change lives in Ohio, Indiana, and Kentucky? Because that's my number one responsibility.
Yeah, that's such a good one. And that's so true. Every time we change people's lives, when we look at it like that, it grows. So yeah, that's awesome. Yep. Man, I just thought of one more too. I wish I would have asked, every year I say this, that I wish I would have spent more time with my cousin Anna and her boys. And I don't know what just made me think of that, but I did. And I so wish I'd have done that this year. So I got to get that on my calendar for 2020. That just made me, I just looked down and saw something that made me think about that. Okay, so the fifth question, and gosh, we got to hurry through these actually. This should have been two episodes. So the fifth one is, what positive habits did you form this year? And I will say just a couple. So the first one is I formed a positive habit of being able to watch and listen to church more, because with traveling and not being at, you know, home or my home base or whatever on Sundays, I missed a lot of church, I felt like, last year. And so this year I have like 4 to 5 really great churches that I love to listen to and watch. And I get there every time I possibly can on a Sunday. But when I cannot physically be there, I feel like I have my go-tos now. So I'm listening and watching a lot more. And that was a big habit that I'm glad that I put into play in 2019. The other one is, and you know this, but I did that food sensitivity and allergy testing, and I've stuck to that. I've stuck to not eating those things.
I know. Everything I thought about eating in the beach house was beef, and I'm like, dang, Dana can't do beef.
I know, and honestly, I probably can re-enter that back in now, but I'm glad that I did because I feel better. I mean, I really do. I feel better. I don't feel bloated and just, I don't know, I feel better. So picking up positive eating habits around that and kind of sticking to those. And that's something I've wanted to do for years and have never done, that allergy testing or food sensitivity. I think it's called the Pinner test. And so I'm glad that I did that. And then the other thing is I am following, which this one's kind of a funny one because I know we're trying to get him to be a guest on our podcast, but I'm following more of the Prophet First. And so I've picked up some good habits around that. Although I will say having like a million checking accounts is borderline driving me a little bit crazy. So that part I don't necessarily love, but I'm sticking to it, and it's a habit that I'm sticking to. So that was a good one too.
Well, that's awesome. And Mike, by the way, Mike already said he would be on our podcast, so we just got to get him scheduled. We'll do that real soon. I was been waiting for our calendar thing to get set up so that we could do that. So yeah. For me, the positive habits, definitely intermittent fasting. That is a habit I don't even have to worry about or think about anymore. It's just part of who I am. It'll be part of who I am forever. So I'm real proud of that because normally I have to try a habit 5 or 10 times before it becomes something I really stick with. And then another one that I formed that I'm real happy about is I have made a plan on working out no matter where I'm at, specifically with a trainer. So I either have the name of every location where I go or I have a physical trainer in that location, because what I was finding is I would come home, work with my trainer when I was at home, but then when I'd go on the road for 2 weeks or 3 weeks or whatever, I wouldn't do any weights. And so getting that into a habit has been awesome. And then
have you found somebody for Branson too?
Not Branson yet. That's a good one. No, because most of the time we're there, we're only there for a couple of days and we're working.
Yeah, that's true.
But I could probably go over to Big Cedar and get somebody, which, by the way, I want to go back and say, you've inspired me on your church stuff too. So you've been a big inspiration.
Thanks.
Because I hear you talking about your podcast. And so we were missing a lot of church too. So my new habit is we listen to podcasts from our church, Matt Chandler, the Village.
Yeah, he's one of my 5. I love Matt Chandler.
He did a great sermon this week. So listen to it on Tuesday. It was awesome today. It was awesome. And then my third and last one is I have been addicted to the Juve red light therapy. I use that religiously, and it's now part of my health regimen, and it's just a habit that I very seldom miss.
So I think by the time this comes out next week, I'm pretty sure, hopefully, I'll make Adam not listen to it until then. But I did. I got him that for one of those for Christmas. So secretively, I'm like, I can't wait to use it too because I knew you said you loved it.
Yep, love it.
Yeah. Okay, so then the last question is, what bad habits did you shed? And I had a really hard time with this one. And the only thing that I even came up with, which I do feel like I shed a little bit and I can always get better at, is just over-promising or over-committing. And I've tried to be very intentional with that this year. And I think anytime I tend to go to that, it's because I'm missing a person. So I know that that's kind of what it was for me over the last couple of years. Although this year, I purposely have really thought about every single thing that I say that I'm going to do. Can I really do that? So
I don't know if it was you I was telling this to or not, but one of the things that helped me a few years ago, because I was getting so many requests to go teach everywhere, is I would say, I think my calendar is full for 2020, but let me check on that and get back with you. So what I did was I gave them a no, and then I would go check. And then that way the no is not as hard for me to say because I've actually already given them no. I don't know if it was you I was telling that to or not, or someone else who was struggling. But what I needed was the space to get away from the question.
Yep.
Which, did you have another one?
No, that's it. Mm-mm.
Which leads me to my first one, which is because I'm a quick start, which means... Quick start means how quick someone takes action. And there's like only a scale of 10 and I'm like a 9, probably a 9 plus plus, which what that means is if you're a quick start, you say yes before you even know what the question is.
Yeah.
And so because I know that about myself, I've learned to stop and not immediately say yes. Give myself some kind of filter. Like I said, I would say, hey, I think my schedule's pretty much full for that kind of stuff in 2020, but let me get back to you. That gave me space to get away from it, because quick starts will say yes before you even finish asking me what you want me to do, you know. And so that's been a good one that I've shed this year, is saying yes so quickly. And then number two is I'm learning to give myself space and time to think more, because I just like to go and, you know, I do love learning in motion, but I do think having some space and time to just do your thinking is good also. And I don't ever leave space for that. So trying to get rid of that habit is helped me to say, okay, I'm just going to give myself some space and I'm going to think for a little while. I'm not going to cram everything so full that I have no room for thinking space, which I bought myself a cute little box that's a black box. It says think, and I've just set it on my desk. And I'm going to get a real cushy chair in here for next year that's just going to be my thinking chair like John Maxwell has.
I love that.
The third and final one, what habit did you shed, is the non-planning. I have never been a big planner. You know, I'll kind of decide in my mind what I want to accomplish, and then my subconscious just goes to work to make it happen, and then the good Lord helps too. But I don't really do a lot of like really planning anymore, and so putting that habit of not planning, getting rid of the bad habit of not planning, I got rid of that, because there's so much value in just planning out, what do I want to do? Would I love something for the next 25 years? What do I want my, you know, old age to look like? What do I, you know, all that kind of stuff is so important. And I used to do a lot more of it. And so I've shed the habit of just never planning and get back to more planning.
Yep. I love that. I love the thinking chair too. That's good. Awesome. All right. Well, those were the six.
Yes. Yes. So I'm excited about that. I'm excited about this planner. I'm excited about our mid-year retreat we're going to do.
Yeah.
That you just committed us to and all that good stuff. And so we are about out of time. We probably took this one a little bit long, but Dana, would there be any final thoughts that you'd want to add to people as they start thinking about leaving 2019 behind and moving into 2020?
You know, the only thing I would say is take time to do this stuff, because actually us talking about these things on the podcast has made me do it when I probably wouldn't have otherwise. And it feels so good. I love doing this and being able to reflect and then plan for next year. So I would just say, I know we all kind of, everybody wants to shut down for a little bit over the holidays, but try to take some time and actually answer these six questions and then also write down your intentions, you know, for next year. What are those things that you really want to get to the end of the year and do? Because I think if we just could slow down for long enough to actually do this stuff, it makes a big difference.
Totally agree. Totally agree. And I hope, Dana, that some of people listening to this podcast, their intention is to give us a great review.
Yes.
Make sure they follow us. If they like our podcast, send links to someone that they care about in the real estate business that they think we might be able to help a little bit. And remember, if you have a situation, a question, challenge that you would love Dana and I to help you with, or you'd love to come on our podcast and share, we'd love to have you do that. Just submit your name to us at info@lindamckissack.com. Be sure and give us a brief description. And the more you describe where you are in your business and life, the more we're going to be able to help you. And you can also reach out to us on Instagram at @everythinglifeinrealestate. And Dana, I will probably, I guess next week will it be after Christmas?
Yes, it will be. So have a Merry Christmas.
52nd episode and Merry Christmas.
We will
have one more before the new year though, right? So I don't have to wish you a new year yet.
Yes, no, we'll have one more before the new year.
All right. Well, Merry Christmas, everyone. And thanks for joining us today. And Dana, I'll talk to you next week.
Be sure to subscribe for more business strategies and tactics to inspire you to live an abundant real estate life. Don't forget to rate and review so we can bring you the best content. Find this and other valuable information at everythinglifeandrealestate.com.